For those of you I've not had a chance to meet, my name is Bob Stauffer. I am the National Director of Church Health. We don't know exactly what that means yet, but, you know, we'll make it up as we go. So, or better, Dean will make it up as we go, if you know Dean at all well. One of the things that is really important to us is communicating the most important things. And so we, under our area of responsibility is church health, evangelism, and transitional pastoring. And so when I started this position, I started to think, how can we best help the local church? How do we deliver resources to the local church that's going to help them in these three areas? And my answer to that in my tiny little brain was churches really need coaches. They need somebody to walk alongside them in their particular situation and help them to understand the principles in each of these areas and to deliver resources through the denomination to the local church. Well, if we're going to have coaches, where do they come from? We need coordinators in each presbytery. And so we have been about the process of identifying in each presbytery a church health coordinator who will help identify and train coaches in the resources that might help them be more effective in all that they do. And where do you get those people? We have a national church health team that has helped identify coordinators, and we create and pour resources into the coordinators, through the coordinators, to the coaches, through the coaches, to the churches. So that's the structure that we're trying to build. We are very blessed to say as we stand here today that 14 of our 16 presbyteries, soon to be 16 presbyteries, 14 of our 16 presbyteries now have coordinators. So we're very excited about that and encourage you to find out who is the coordinator in your presbytery, and there will be things throughout the week to help you do that. Get to know them, encourage them, strengthen them, and allow them to be a resource to help you do what you need to do. And so our church, National Church Health team is Michael Davis, Jim Farrell, Bruce Allison, Bill Rash, Glenn Myers, and Jeff Moore. And I think they're all here today. Eventually, we'll all be wearing our red shirts, our fancy new red shirts. Just saying, we have shirts. So we must be doing something, right? No. And then our coordinators, many of them are scattered here throughout the room. In fact, if you're a coordinator, why don't you just stand real quick, if you're a coordinator, your presbytery, just so you can see some of them who are in the room. So be an encouragement to these folks as they help you do what you do. Thanks, everyone. Many of you, I'm sure, have read Canoeing the Mountains, the book. If you've not, you ought to read it. It's an amazing book on adaptive leadership. Todd Bolsinger, when he was with a group of our national leaders, made an interesting comment one time. He said, every successful organization is sustained by one great idea. Every successful organization is sustained by one great idea. And his thought there is that one idea drives everything. Everything else flows out of that one singular idea. And before I forget this, you have the packet in front of you of papers. There is a blank paper at the end. Don't write on that paper because you're going to need that later for something else. But feel free to take notes on the other things. And so the question is, what is the great idea? There's an old proverb that says, the goal of leadership is to keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. So what is the main thing for the EPC? Well, fortunately, we have a mission statement that reflects the main thing. And that is what Dean just talked about. Here is our mission statement. The EPC exists to carry out the Great Commission of Jesus as a denomination of Presbyterian, Reformed, Evangelical, and missional churches. That's the big idea. That ought to drive our denominational stuff. It ought to drive everything we do in our presbyteries, and it ought to drive everything we do in our individual churches. It's the main thing. And so with that in mind, we're going to focus on the primacy, the importance of that idea today in the area of evangelism. So why focus on evangelism? Well, it's the main thing. It's the main idea. But there's a reason to focus on it for three particular reasons. The first, of course, is the Word of God. If you have to look very hard for the importance of evangelism in the Word of God, you need a new Bible, right? It's It's in there quite often, obviously, in places like Luke 19:10. There are two places in the New Testament that says Jesus came to seek something. The first is in John chapter 4. He came to seek those who worship him in spirit and in truth. And the second is in Luke 19:10, where it says Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. And if that's Jesus' call and Jesus' burden, it ought to be our burden as disciples. And of course, the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, we could outline and delineate that, and we'll talk more about that later in the week. So the biblical principles ought to drive the primacy of evangelism in what we do. Secondly, our founding fathers and mothers of the denomination believed very strongly that evangelism was what would separate us from all the other denominations, or as we say, the other split peas, right? We listened to them. I had the blessing of being a part of the denomination. I was in the first class ordained in the EPC, so I heard those guys, their passion for evangelism, and they said, if we don't do anything else, we're going to do evangelism well. That's going to drive everything we do. So we have historical roots, and that was reflected, thirdly, then, in our founding documents. So you see in your pamphlet there, EPC Perspectives on Evangelism. This is just some places where the idea of the primacy of evangelism, that it's going to be our main thing, that it's going to be our driving force, is reflected in those purpose statements. So we have scripture, we have a historical background in the EPC, and we have our documents which tell us this is what ought to drive us. Now, the fact is, we're not doing a great job in evangelism. There's always all kinds of ways we can take apart the statistics and look at the denominational things. You can look at adult baptisms. For many years in the EPC, I don't know what it's been recently, but for many years in the EPC, there has been less than one adult baptism per church per year. One adult baptism per church per year. And if you look at the statistics, many times it's 0, 0, 0. I know it's not a perfect statistic, but it is something that helps us reflect how we're doing in evangelism denominationally. And my passion as the National Outreach Director is that we move into a new day where we make the main thing again. Amen? It's got to be what drives what we do and how we think. There are lots of reasons people don't do evangelism. Fear, intimidation, they're afraid of the culture, loss of biblical conviction about evangelism. And there's lots of reasons that we can't necessarily control or especially speak about today. But there is one reason that most people share about why they don't share the gospel message. And do you know what it is? Nobody ever told us how. That our churches have gone for years and years and years without really teaching people how to do evangelism. And as I became the national director, I said, you know what? That's one thing we can do something about. That's one thing we can speak into to make sure that we take away at least the excuse that no one ever taught us how to share our faith effectively. We can and we have to do something about that. And shame on us as leaders if we're not reflecting this value in our churches, in our presbyteries, and in our culture with people who are far from God. We need to be an evangelistic church and creating evangelistic conversations. So that's what today's about. But we want to go one step farther than just having evangelistic conversations. We want to create an evangelistic culture. We want to create an evangelistic culture in our churches and in our presbyteries and in our denomination. And so I'm going to introduce to you today, some of you have already heard of or met, you see in front of you your book, Turning Everyday Conversations into Gospel Conversations. And it's been an amazing tool already as we've begun to roll it out as our tool. We believe very strongly denominationally that having one tool that we all use together is really important. That we can all lean into it together at all levels, at all judicatories of the EPC. And so we've been in conversation for a long time with Dr. Scroggins and the folks at Family Church to help us come along and create an evangelistic culture. So I'm going to introduce Dr. Scroggins and Reverend Thomas. Let me just give you a quick introduction to them. Jimmy is the senior pastor of Family Church, an amazing thing that they'll talk about at our lunch today, a network of neighborhood churches in South Florida. He's a member of the Board of Trustees at Palm Beach Atlantic University and Lifeway Christian Resources. Teaches as a visiting professor at Southern and Southeastern Baptist Seminaries, bachelor's degree from Jacksonville University, an MDiv and a PhD from Southern Baptist Seminary in Louisville. Prior to his call in West Palm Beach, he served as the dean of Boyce College and a student ministry teaching pastor at Highview Baptist Church in Louisville. Jimmy and his wife will be introduced to you. They have 8 children. And he is a highly sought-after speaker around the world and throughout the United States. But beyond all of that and being the author of this book, Jimmy is a man who passionately runs hard after God and is very serious about seeing evangelistic opportunities be created in all of our churches, in all of our lives, in all the things that we do. And so we were excited to have him. Reverend Todd Thomas is a pastor in the network, pastor of Sherbrooke Baptist Church in Lake Worth, Florida, and part of the network of family churches. Todd is a very gifted worship leader and a gifted evangelist and a gifted pastor, but more importantly than that, he is married to my daughter, Sarah. And more importantly than that, he is the father of 3 of my grandchildren. And we lovingly refer to him as the crazy Indian who stole my daughter and moved her far away. So, actually, I'm over it. Sort of. But these men are living out the gospel with these passionate gospel conversations. So would you welcome with me Dr. Jimmy Scroggins and Reverend Todd Thomas.
Thanks, Bob. That's going great so far. Anyways, hey, welcome everybody. Glad that we get to be here. It is an honor for us to be here. Bob, thanks for that very kind introduction, and thank you for sharing your daughter Sarah and your grandchildren with us at Family Church. We're literally blessed by you every day because of that, and it is an honor to get to be with you guys. So I do want to know, Bob gave a very big introduction, but the truth is my name's just Jimmy. Nobody calls me Dr. Scroggins. All right, so even my kids, when somebody finds out, oh, your dad's a doctor, my kids will say, yeah, but not the kind that can actually help anybody. And so, which is facts. And so we are pastors at a network of neighborhood churches in South Florida. So what I want you to know, like, we're going to talk some today about evangelism and about the tool that we use and that some of you are starting to use, and we want to talk about how to build an evangelistic culture, but I do want you to know that we're just pastors who are trying to figure this out. So what we're going to say, sometimes we may speak as if we really know what we're talking about, but underscore, we don't know what we're talking about. We are in the middle of trying to figure this out, just like you are. So what we're talking about today is the things that we are learning as we are trying to do this stuff, because we're actually like working pastors. We're not traveling speakers. That's not primarily what we do. So we go to like staff meeting. We prepare sermons, we do funerals and weddings and marriage counseling, and we're just regular working, bring your lunch bucket to work every day pastors. And that's the way that our church works. And even though our church has thousands and thousands of people and multiple, we have 15 locations around 3 different counties and multiple languages in South Florida, but the truth is we're a family of neighborhood churches. So no single congregation, no single church is a mega church. We've actually abandoned the regional mega church strategy in favor of a family of neighborhood churches. That's what we do. We're not anti-mega church. We're grateful for mega churches, but that's who we are in South Florida. And so we're going to talk today a little bit about evangelism. But before we do, what I'd like to do, if I could, is just give you a devotion, which I'm a little intimidated to do because all of you guys are professional Christians. And, you know, all the people that are not here, we all get paid to be good, and they're all good for nothing. But we're gonna talk today about evangelism. And before we do, I do want to share with you a thought from the scriptures that's been really important to me, because do you guys agree that the work of evangelism and discipleship can be discouraging? Do you guys agree with that? Have you guys ever had the experience of deeply desiring evangelism and discipleship and yet not seeing the results that you hoped for? Or working hard and praying hard and putting it out there and just other people not buying in. And I want you to know that we have the same experience at family church, so we know what that feels like. I do want to say this is a picture of our family. This my wife, Kristen. We've been married for 28 years. We do have 8 children, 6 sons and 2 daughters. We also have 2 grandchildren. And so our children are, my oldest son is 26, and he and his wife are, he's in the United States Army. He's an infantry officer. And they have a little boy, and they live out in Louisiana. I have another son who's in the ministry. He's on staff at a church in Naples, Florida. He and his wife and their little girl live there not too far from us in Naples. And then I have 2 boys that play college football, Division II football out in Missouri. And then I've got a son that's about to go in. He's in a few weeks, we're taking him to the United States Merchant Marine Academy, where he's going to play football up there. And then I've got 2 girls in high school, and my son that's with me over here, Caleb, and he's going into the 7th grade. So we have every life stage all at once, and we're doing it and having a great time. And people always ask us, you know, that's our family, you know, are you one of those Christians who thinks that birth control is a sin? And I always tell them, we don't think birth control is a sin, we just never figured out how to use it effectively. And there's the result. When we were about to have our 5th child, my father-in-law is a wonderful guy, he's in heaven now, but he's a Vietnam vet, super tough guy, Christian guy. I called him and I said, my wife wouldn't tell him. She said, I'm not telling my dad, you tell him I'm pregnant again. I said, okay, I'll call him. So I called him, I said, George, we're gonna have another baby. And he says, son, I know you're poor as a church mouse in the ministry. Would you like me to spring for cable? And I appreciated that because we didn't have cable and that was really nice. Really nice. And I've been at family church since 2008, and the hard work of pastoring a church is just hard. Like, the more you do it, the more you just realize the weight of what Paul was talking about when he said, this is how come I can't sleep, this is how come I can't eat, because of the pressure that I feel for the people in the churches. And even though Jesus said that his yoke is easy and his burden is light, there's even Jesus came to the point where he was sweating blood because of the spiritual engagement that he was involved in. And I know that you feel the same way every day, and so do I. And this is a tough thing. So I want to read you one text of scripture. You're familiar with it. Usually when we teach on this text from John chapter 21, we usually teach about the way that Jesus dealt with Peter and John. But I want to do kind of the run up to that. So this is John chapter 21, starting in verse 1. I want to read some scripture, share some ideas, and we'll jump into our evangelism strategy. The Word of God says, after this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and 2 others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. And they said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? Do you have any fish? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and he threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but they were about 100 yards off. Now, when we read this text, and some of you are super duper Bible scholars, and you know everything just by memory of every chapter in the New Testament. I don't, but you'll probably immediately recognize some similarities to another story you might have read in the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke chapter 5. In that story, Jesus was actually teaching from the boat, and then he told the disciples to launch out into deeper water and fish. In that story, Luke chapter 5, like this one, they'd been fishing all night without catching anything. In that story, Peter objected to what Jesus was trying to get him to do. And he said he didn't want to do it, but Peter did it anyways. And then they caught so many fish that their nets broke, and the boats filled up, and they almost sank. And that's when Peter falls to his knees in the pile of fish in the sinking boat and says to Jesus, from now on, Peter, I want you to fish for men. So as a result of that miracle and Jesus' words, Peter and James and John leave their nets and their boats, and they go and follow Jesus to be fishers of men. But that story happened at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. When this story happens, Jesus has been crucified, he's been raised from the dead, and this is, I think, the fourth appearance of Jesus in the Gospels. And in that story, Luke chapter 5, they knew it was Jesus before they threw their nets out. In that story, they fished in the middle of the lake instead of 100 yards out. And in that story, Jesus was in the boat, but in this story, Jesus is on the shore. And in that story, there were multiple boats. In this story, there's only one boat. And in that story, the point was to validate the miraculous power of Jesus so that they would follow him. And in this story, the point is to resurrect, is to validate the resurrection of Jesus. And so what do we mean that they needed to validate the resurrection of Jesus? Well, if you keep reading in verse 9, it says this: when they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. And it's interesting that there's already fish. So they have the fish, but somehow Jesus shows up. He's already got fish. So he didn't actually need them to give him fish. He could get fish on his own. And the only reason they had fish anyways was Jesus told them where to put the net. Anyhow, Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. So the disciples had talent, the disciples had expertise, the disciples had knowledge. They've been fishing their whole lives. They knew a lot about it. They were experts. But for whatever reason, after doing everything that they knew to do, even the things that had produced results for them before didn't produce results for them now. It wasn't working. And so they see Jesus, and Jesus says to them, keep doing what you've been doing, but do it one more time. Just do it one more time. He doesn't tell them to do something different. He doesn't teach them a different method. He doesn't show them a unique way to fish. Do what you've been doing, only now, just do it. Just do it one more time, because I'm telling you, do it where I'm telling you to do it. And this time, when Jesus gets involved, their nets fill up. And I don't want to be too allegorical in all of this, but I do think there's something to learn here about fishing, because the first story of Jesus fishing in Luke chapter 5, when this similar story happens, Jesus uses that story to tell them, now I want you to fish for men, the work of evangelism. And now here, after the resurrection, Jesus is having another story very similar. They can you know that when they're out there and they're gathering the fish, they're thinking, we've seen this movie before, haven't we, boys? We have been here before. 3 years ago, we were doing this exact same thing in this exact same lake. That's when we started doing the work of evangelism. And now here Jesus comes after the resurrection of Jesus, and he's got us doing the same thing with the same results. What is Jesus doing? Well, there's seasons when you're going to feel like you've been doing the right things, everything you know how to do, for a long time. And you're not going to get the results that you were hoping for. But there's something powerful about this idea that Jesus is asking us to throw out our nets one more time. And I like it that Jesus does. Now, I know, because I'm a Baptist, so you guys are probably, some of you guys are side-eyeing me already. Because you're like, I bet he's an Arminian. He's a Baptist, and he's all hyped up about evangelism. He probably thinks it's our work that does it all. I actually don't. You know, I actually went to Southern Seminary. I taught at Southern Seminary. I was trained by Al Mohler. Now, that's not a total Presbyterian, but we're halfway. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? We're right there. But even though we're confident and dependent on the providence of God and the sovereignty of God in all things, there are seasons when Jesus is going to ask you to do something, and Jesus chooses to use us, and our efforts and our work does matter. That's why Jesus, he always does miracles like that. What happened at the very first miracle he did? He's going to turn the water into wine, which that's not very Baptist. But anyway, he's going to do his water into wine at the first miracle. And what does he say? Hey, boys, you guys go fill up the jars. I'll turn the water into wine. Or what happens with the feeding of the 5,000? You bring me the five fishes and the two loaves. I'll multiply it, and then you go pick up the baskets, just as kind of living proof. You guys throw up the nets one more time. I'll make sure the 153 fish get in the nets. God sends the workers into his own field that he owns, and then the workers get to bring in the harvest to the Lord. Does he need us to do it? Jesus already had fish before they went fishing. I bet they were frustrated when they pulled up on them, dragged the nets, and they're like, are you kidding me right now? He already has fish. But that's how he works. So a great Baptist that Presbyterians love, Charles Spurgeon, said, put no dependence upon societies, upon committees, upon ministries, upon anything that we can do. Let us work as if it all depended upon us, but let us come to God depending upon him, knowing of a surety that it does not rest with us, but with him alone. Let us send forth the missionaries to the heathen. Let us send forth our men into the dark streets and lanes of London. Let us scatter tracts. Let us distribute the word of God. Let us send forth preachers by scores from our school of the prophets. But when this is done, let us not sit still and say, now it is all accomplished. Good must come of it. Nay, Lord, unless thy blessing descend from on high, as well we might have done nothing, for no eternal results can follow. It's all dependent on the work of God and the Spirit of God, but we do have a part in God's process. And the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is God's plan A, and he doesn't have a plan B. And we must do our part and fulfill our role. So we're not really looking for a silver bullet. I know if you came here and go, I can't wait because these Baptists are going to give me a silver bullet that's going to transform everything. There's no silver bullet. So you're like, all right, well, I'm leaving. Well, don't leave. I still think it could be fun, but there's no silver bullet. It's about preaching the word. It's about doing evangelism. It's about making disciples. It's about caring for people. It's about caring for the widow and the orphan. It's about resisting the urge to push people down and push them out. It's about embracing the gospel imperative to pull people in and lift them up and point them to Christ. The whole world is confused about everything. The world cannot even tell the difference between a boy and a girl. But Christians don't need to be confused. We have a book. We have the gospel of Jesus Christ. And while we're busy implementing our leadership principles, being flexible and adaptable and agile, it's really about, will you and I throw out our nets one more time? Some of you came to this conference today and you're tired. But I hope what you're encouraged to do as a result of all of this General Assembly meeting, after meeting with your friends and reconnecting with your roots and reconnecting with your purpose and being rejuvenated by all of the teaching that's going to happen and all of the good decisions that are going to be made, I hope even if you're tired, you'll go home determined to throw out your nets one more time. Even if your crowd is small, it's kind of fun to come to a big church, say, big facilities, man. I think you could drive up semi-trucks through their foyer. They've got gymnasiums and sound systems, and the children's facility is amazing, and the auditorium, and some of us come in here and we just get facility envy. You know, we just come in here like, man, I'm just a regular pastor of a regular church. I don't get to be a pastor of a whole city. Even if your crowd is small, I think Jesus would say, go back home and throw out your nets one more time. Even if your offering isn't coming in as well as you thought it was going to, because you realize that the top-end givers that you have are getting squeezed because the stock market is and the regular paycheck tithers are getting squeezed because milk's $5 a gallon and gas won't stop going up. But even if your offerings aren't coming in the way that you hoped, throw out your nets one more time. Even if you aren't getting the response that other people seem to be getting, throw out your nets one more time. Some of you are saying, that's not me, man. I'm riding high. My nets are full of fish. They are about to break. We can't take care of all the people that God is bringing. Praise God. you two go home and throw out your nets one more time. Because sometimes when you believe the gospel, because here's the deal. Whether you're in a small town or a big city, all of us are swimming in an ocean of lostness and brokenness. Do you guys agree with that? All of us are swimming in... You ever talk to a church planter about where they're planting their church? Every church planter has a reason why the place that they are planting the church is the most lost people, least church place in the world. Chattanooga, Tennessee, nobody here has ever heard of God. We've got to have a church. Birmingham, Alabama, we've got to have... And I tell you the truth, we need more good churches in Chattanooga and Birmingham, just like we do in San Francisco and Portland and New York City. But wherever you go, you're going to swim in an ocean of brokenness and lostness. We do still live in the United States of America, most of us, which is, despite whatever problems you may think we have, the freest country in the history of the world. We have more freedom to share the gospel of Jesus than any other Christians have ever had in the history of the world right now. And even though inflation is going up, and you might think that our economy is not doing as well as you wish it was, but the truth is we are the most prosperous and wealthy Christians in the history of the world. And we have a real gospel that really saves. If you have an ocean of lostness, all the freedom to share the gospel that any Christian has ever had, all the resources, more resources than Christians have ever had in the history of the world, and you got a real gospel that really saves, what could possibly be the missing ingredient in this equation? Somebody has to obey the word of Jesus Christ and throw out our nets one more time. Let me pray for you and we'll talk about the three circles. God in heaven, thank you for the men and women in this room, brothers and sisters. We thank you for the word of God, the example of Jesus and the apostles. God, help us to embrace this. Help us to lean into it. God, I pray against the devil who's always trying to discourage us and distract us and convince us that it won't work. I thank you that it doesn't work except for it's a miracle. I thank you for the miraculous power of Jesus Christ crucified for our sins, raised from the dead, coming again. And when we embrace that, believe it and live it and talk to people as if it's true because it is. And I pray for some in this room who may be a little bit discouraged or jaded or tired or cynical. Would you encourage them today and through this entire meeting? Let all of us be willing and eager to throw out our nets one more time. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You know, I was a... freshman at Boyce College and young PhD student who had hair then, was teaching a bunch of us 18-year-olds about evangelism. And 20 years later, we're serving at the same church and we're doing the same thing. The primacy of evangelism, as Bob put it, is something that we're passionate about and we're excited about. We want to do everything we can to encourage you with. Bob did mention that I stole his daughter from him and moved her across the country. This is the Thomas family. Those are three of the Stauffer grandkids over there, and my beautiful wife, Sarah. And, you know, when I met the Stauffers as a ninth grade kid in Youngstown, Ohio, before I ever had aspirations of being in the family, you know what Bob Stauffer was talking about with his church? The primacy of evangelism. And I hope that all of us, man, it might feel like I've been doing this for a long time and it gets tiring. Look, don't grow weary. And take that challenge today. Let's cast our nets. Let's keep moving forward. I'm thankful that there was somebody that did that in New City, New York for me. There was somebody who kept casting their net. Pastor named Dave Vandenberg, a little Christian Missionary Alliance church in an all-Jewish part of New York. And that's where I heard the message of the gospel. I repented and placed my faith in Jesus Christ, and my life has forever been transformed. So when you get tired, you grow a little weary of doing this, remember that somebody did it for you. Remember that there was somebody who was faithful They were naive, right, to take Jesus at his word that, man, we're going to preach the gospel. How will people hear? How will they respond? They took those commands in Romans 11 pretty seriously. And you're sitting here today as someone who has been born of God. Your life has been transformed. So when you grow weary, just remember that the stuff we're talking about has influenced your soul. So let's keep doing it for somebody else. I love talking about having an evangelistic church culture. I love talking about my family. So over there, my son, Kate, is 8. Annalise is 6. Indy, you know they name hurricanes after people in Florida. There should be a Hurricane Indy. The third born, she is a hurricane. But my daughter, Annalise, there, she's a treasure to us. Annalise, a cancer survivor. She's 3 years cancer-free now. We are excited about what God's doing in her life. But I'll tell you a funny story about Annalise. When Annalise was 2, right about when she was starting her treatments, she comes over to me. I'm sitting on my recliner in my living room. She comes over to me, and I just kind of give her a pat. She's wearing one of those onesie jammies. I give her kind of a pat on the back, pat on the behind. Hey, honey, what are you up to? And my hand was wet. I'm like, okay, something's happened here. Annalise, you know, pat her on the behind again. She's soaked. Hey, Annalise, did you pee your pants? And she looks at me now. You could tell there. She's got really, really big eyes, and they're like bug eyes as a kid, as a 2-year-old. So she's like, no, I didn't pee my pants. I'm like, honey, I don't know what other explanation there is. You're all wet right here. Did you pee your pants? Oh, I didn't pee my pants. So I look behind her, and there's like this little trail of liquid in the kitchen. I said, Annalise, did you pee your pants? No, Daddy. I no pee my pants. Okay, I see the bathroom light is on and a trail of toilet paper. Annalise, were you trying to get to the potty, go to the potty, and you just didn't make it in time? Were you trying to go and you peed your pants? Is this what happened? I don't pee my pants. No. And so at this point, I'm like, this child is lying to me. You know, my parental rage is coming out. I'm frustrated. I'm like, am I about to discipline a child for peeing their pants? But I was getting close, right? So I'm looking at her, and I'm like, man, what is happening here? Annalise, look Daddy in the eye. Tell me the truth. Did you pee your pants? She's, no. At that point, my son, who is minding his own business, up the steps of our house, he starts walking down the steps. And Annalise looks over at Cade. She makes eye contact, and she goes, Cade, did you pee my pants? I love that story because you know what that story reminds me of? That in the Garden of Eden, what have we done? We have deferred responsibility. That's what my daughter taught me in that moment, and it took me straight back to the very beginning of the Bible. But here's where I know we get that about our sin and not wanting things to be our fault. But you know what I think we've done as professional Christians? We've kind of like deferred responsibility when it comes to the area of evangelism, right? We kind of rely on the campus ministries to do it. Crew's awesome. Campus outreach is awesome. FCA is fantastic. They're doing a killer job. The BCMs, all these different organizations, they're great. They're the ones that do the work of evangelism, right? There's other people in our communities. That's the church that's kind of evangelistic. I hope that all of us would resist the urge to defer the responsibility that God has given every single Christian, every single believer in Jesus Christ. It's all of our responsibility. And I think this discussion on creating an evangelistic church culture has to start there, where every single one of us, we embrace the responsibility that God has given us to take the gospel, not just to the ends of the earth, but across the street, to the people in our communities who desperately need Jesus. The way that we encourage our church with this and where we start is through focused prayer. So you have some places to jot some notes down, and there's some ways that we do this as a church, but I'll just tell you this. It has to start here. It has to start kind of like with Paul in Romans 10:1, right? When he was thinking about his Jewish brothers and sisters, and he says, my heart's desire and my prayer for them is for their salvation. We have to teach our people, and we ourselves have to be on our knees praying for the salvation of people around us. We've actually done this in a couple ways in our church, and I think you can do this as well. We host something for 7 days, multiple times a year, where we call our church to pray. 6 a.m., we open all of our buildings. Anyone who will come, we're going to pray together, and we're going to ask the Lord of the harvest to send workers to the harvest so that we can continue to reap what we've been sowing. So we're calling people to prayer. When it comes to even just using this tool that we're going to show you in a little bit, challenging our people to have specific people in mind they're praying for. A family member, a neighbor, a coworker, a friend. There are people all around us every day who are in brokenness, who need Jesus. And so we want to encourage people to pray for them. Something we've given to our people looks like this. You could pretty much create your own version of it, but it's a way for us to hold, to pray with them for people that they're thinking about. But just an opportunity for them to identify people in their world that they want to get the gospel to. This is so important because, you know, in our context, it can feel kind of overwhelming, and we need to go to the Lord and remind ourselves that we're not God, that He is, and He's the one who has the power to save, and we just get to be a part of that process on mission with Him. But in our context, you know, we have, 15 neighborhood churches, but we are in a part of the world where it's about 95% unchurched. On any given Sunday, 95% of the population in South Florida does not get up and go to a church. And that's about 2 million people represented there. There are roughly around 200 gospel preaching churches, and less than 150,000 people in worship any given Sunday. So you know what? And we have to be broken about that, and we have to seek the Lord about that. If we're going to make a dent, we need to do everything we can to ask the Lord, to seek the Lord, to do something about this and to be a part of what He is doing around us. And so this is paramount to the whole thing. If you haven't called your people to pray over the lostness in your community and specific people that are in their world, it's a great, great place to start. Second is choosing a tool, choosing a gospeling tool. We use that word because we want to get the gospel to people, right? Choosing a gospeling tool, an evangelistic tool. And here's the thing. It doesn't really matter which tool you choose. There's a lot of great ones. You know, some of you remember Evangelism Explosion, right? And Dr. Kennedy, how many of you were trained in that? So, like, you guys are like when we talk about professional Christians, you're the ones we're talking about here. If you can do EE, you guys are like another level. All right? How many of you were trained in the four spiritual laws or KGP? All right? Romans Road. We've all got them. We've all been trained in a variety of tools. Here's the thing. We think it's important, though, for you to choose one and stick to it. And you might be like, well, why is that important? We're the professional Christians in the room, and we're probably all willing to acknowledge we don't even use the tools we have. What do you think the everyday person in your church is dealing with when they get a conversation started with somebody who's in brokenness? We want to give them a simple way and a reproducible way for them to express the gospel and what Christ has done for them, the good news of the gospel, the good news of what happened at the cross and through the resurrection of Jesus. We want to give them a way that they can do that, and a way that they can do that quickly if they have a short amount of time. And we think it's important to choose a tool. The toolbox method will probably confuse more of your people than help them. So we think it's important for you to choose a tool. And again, like, this is the tool that we use, and I think now the EPC is adopting this. But I remember hearing Steve Shogren say, the best kind of evangelism is the evangelism you do. So, you know, pick that tool, and man, you got to use it, and use it to the best of your ability. Here's why we use the three circles, though. And I think this maybe will help simplify this for you. We use the three circles because we found it to be intuitive, easily learned, and easily reproduced in the lives of new believers. Easily learned and easily reproduced. In fact, you saw that picture of my son, Cade, 8. We just celebrated his baptism recently. And you know what Cade could do for you here as an 8-year-old? Now, I know Cade's kind of like, he's exceptionally smart, and it's not because I'm his dad. Somewhere the Lord just, you know, he's an exceptionally smart kid, but probably about 5 or 6, you know what he could do? He could draw 3 circles. He could talk about what God's done and how to recover and pursue His design. He could do that. It's very easily reproducible. from your kids ministry all the way up to adults, for every seasoned Christian and for new believers. So what we want to do right now is help you think about this. How do you see the book there, how do you turn everyday conversations into gospel conversations? If it's important to choose a tool, and we're going to talk about the three circles, how do you turn everyday conversations into gospel conversations? So Jimmy, why don't you show us the three circles, and we'll talk a little bit in a minute about how this all started, but why don't you just, let's give people the bird's eye view of the tool and show them how to use it.
All right, so the three circles, the three circles was designed as an open source tool. And the reason I like that it's an open source tool, that means that if you see something on here and you're like, I think I would like to add a Bible verse right there, you can. It's your tool. If you say, well, I think, you know, you're using this word, I would prefer to use that word. Again, it's your tool. It's an open source tool. It's not a script. It's not designed like, you know, to me the SEAL Team 6 Special Forces version of evangelism is Evangelism Explosion. But Evangelism Explosion has you memorize like flow charts. If you say this and then they say that, then you got to go over here, and then this is the verse you use in this sense, and it's like, it's comprehensive. But the problem is, it's hard to teach to a new believer. You have to be a pretty aggressive, serious believer to be able to put it all together. I think you'll find this tool to be more intuitive, especially for people who may not have the background in the Bible. And the reason that we came up with this, and we'll talk about it in a minute, is because we were talking to people in South Florida who don't know any Bible verses or any Bible stories when they become Christians. They don't know a lot of Bible verses or Bible stories. And what we found is people who are in our churches, many of them don't know a lot of Bible stories or Bible verses very well. And so how do we teach them to do evangelism? So here's what we came up with. When people share with us a concern, a problem, a challenge that they're facing, and this happens all the time. So someone you know or doesn't know will come up to you and they'll say, hey, I'm having difficulty in my marriage, or I'm having a hard time with my children, or my aging parents, or my medical situation, or my finances, or my business. They'll come up to you and they'll say something, and that gives you an entree to begin to share the gospel. But most people, when someone shares with us, even pastors, when someone shares with us, hey, I'm having difficulty in my marriage or with my business, or I'm struggling with addiction or depression or whatever it is, when that happens, it's almost like our spiritual spider senses start tingling. You know what I'm talking about? Somebody says something, you go, oh, here we go. Here we go. This is where I got to kick in with some Jesus-y talk right here, because they've kind of opened the door. And then you're trying to figure out what is the right thing to say, what's the right way to go at it, and the conversation's going, and then it's kind of moving on, and you're starting to inwardly panic. I'm supposed to say something Jesus-y right now, but the conversation's getting away, and then it's gone, and you don't want to be a complete loser, so you mumble something like, I'll pray for you. And then the conversation's over. And you're like, wow, man, I'm a professional Christian. I got multiple degrees in this stuff. This person opens a door, and the best I can come up with is, I'll pray for you. Beyonce would say that. I mean, what is going on? And so the most challenging thing to do in evangelism is to move from an everyday conversation where somebody opens the door and tells you something they're struggling with, and how do we convert this conversation into a gospel conversation in a way that doesn't feel like they're getting a sales pitch? Because no one wants to be pitched. So how do you do that? So there's three things you have to keep in mind. T, G, I. T, meaning you've got to have some kind of a transition statement. Every gospel tool teaches you to have a transition statement. That's the only way. But if you don't have a transition statement already written, memorized, and in your head that you're ready to use, that's when the conversation gets away from you and you say something weak at the end of the conversation trying to just say something. So my transition statement goes like this. Somebody comes up to me and says, I'm having difficulty in my marriage. I take whatever problem they share with me, and then I use that problem as my transition statement. I do it like this. Somebody says about their marriage, I say, you know, I've been married for 28 years. And marriage definitely has its ups and downs. But I've learned something that's helped me to think about my marriage in a better way. And I'd like to share it with you. And so that's how I did. So I'm asking for permission. I'm identifying with them. I don't have to lie and make up something because they might say, well, you know, my wife's cheating on me, or I'm cheating on my wife, or whatever. I've never had that experience, but I do have a marriage. So I have some way I can identify with them. So like this happened to me a few years ago. I was standing out there on like a pond behind our house, and I'm out there fishing. There's a guy across the pond. I don't really know him, but I see him every once in a while. And we end up kind of fishing over there next to each other. And he leans over to me. And we're talking, hey, what's up? Hey, how's it going? I said, how are you doing? And he goes, man, my wife is a witch. But he didn't call her a witch. And I said, oh. He says, you ever felt like that? Now, that's a trap. And I said, absolutely not. But I've been married for 27 years. Marriage definitely does have its ups and downs. Hey man, I've actually learned something that's helped me think about my marriage and my relationship with my wife in a better way. Do you have time for me to share that with you? You see how easy that is? Because I had another experience. I was on an airplane a few years ago. A lady came in. I'm on the aisle seat. Lady comes in. She's late. She's frazzled. She can't get her suitcase up in the bin. Her hair's all whacked out. She comes in, scooches over, sits down in the middle seat right next to me, and does what I call the female exhale. Have you heard it? And I said, hey, is everything okay? And she says, do you have daughters? I said, I actually do. I have two of them. I got a bunch of sons, too. Parenting is not for wimps, is it? She says, boy, it's not. I said, you know, I've actually learned something that's helped me to think about parenting in a better way than I used to. Could I share that with you? We're on the airplane anyway. Could I share that with you? What the heck? So I start sharing the three circles with her. I get a little napkin out and start drawing it. And it's one of those deals where sometimes you have that divine appointment moment, and I'm sharing the three circles with her, and she is just like leaning in. But not only her, I look up. The person over here is leaning in. The people from behind me are kind of like doing this. The guy over here, I'm doing the three circles for like 10 people. And we start all having this big conversation. I've had so many of these moments. So some of it is just being ready with the transition statement and being ready to identify with them. And the reason I always use the three circles after they share with me a problem, after they share with me a challenge. So that's the transition statement. Once you have a transition statement, you're ready to go, then you've got to have a gospel presentation. How do you transition, but you've got to actually share the gospel of Jesus Christ. So how do you do that? And this is how I do it using the three circles. Let me show you how I've learned to think about marriage in a better way. And it doesn't matter what the issue is. It doesn't matter what the problem is, whether it's a big problem or small problem. I'll say, here's how it is. I've come to believe that God has a design for every area of our life, including marriage, parenting, career, money, dealing with addiction, whatever. God has a design for my life. And you find out God's design by studying the Bible. God, if we will operate according to God's design, we are more likely to experience God's blessing. But all of us have this inborn tendency, this desire to do things our own way. We think we can get there faster or better or have more satisfaction or have more fun if we do things our own way. And so we depart from God's design. And the Bible actually has a word for that when you depart from God's design. And the word the Bible uses is the word sin. And what happens is when we depart from God's design, we always end up in this second circle that I call brokenness. And brokenness is what it feels like when you have departed from God's design. So brokenness is what it feels like when you feel guilty, when you feel ashamed, when you feel regret, when you feel cheap or empty or used. When you feel unsatisfied, unfulfilled, that's the way that brokenness feels. And what happens is the brokenness that we feel makes us want to change. So it's kind of a good thing. But our instinct is always to change. So we'll try, like if I'm in a broken relationship, a toxic relationship, we'll go break and go off and get in another relationship. If I'm discouraged or depressed, I'll go off and maybe I'll drink too much. If I feel like I'm a moral failure, maybe I'll really try to white knuckle it and get more religious. But what we find is that the kind of changes we make on our own don't go deep enough and don't last long enough to really address the brokenness that's inside of us and the causes of the brokenness. And what we find out is the kind of change we need doesn't really come from reaching deep down in here. The kind of change we need actually has to come from somewhere else outside of us. And that's really is the third circle, which is the good news. And the Bible has a word for good news, and the word is gospel. And the gospel, in short, is this: that God knows that we are broken people who've departed from His design, and He knows we can't change ourselves. And so God did a miracle a long time ago. He sent His Son, Jesus, down to earth. And Jesus came to earth, and He never violated God's design one single time. He never sinned. And because of that, He loved people, He cared for people, He healed people, He helped people. But the people that Jesus loved crucified Him on a cross. And when Jesus was crucified on a cross, Jesus did a miracle. Jesus took our sins and our brokenness on Himself. And the reason that's important is because when we sin against God, it is a violation of God's law. When we sin against God, we're separated from God. When we sin against God, we're under the judgment of God. And what Jesus did when He died on the cross, He took all of that judgment and all of that separation and all of that guilt on Himself. And then after He finished paying the penalty for our sins, He died, and then God raised Him from the dead, and He's alive. And now Jesus invites anyone who will to be changed. And the word for change in the Bible, there's a really important word. The word for change in the Bible is the word repent. To change your mind, change your heart, change your direction. You repent and you believe. You believe the story of Jesus, the truth of Jesus, crucified for your sins and raised from the dead. And if you will believe that and receive it by faith, what happens is God forgives you of all of your sins. And God sends the Holy Spirit to live inside of you. And God gives you a new family of people called a church family to help you. And then because of all of that, God gives you the opportunity to recover and pursue His design for your life from wherever you are right now. Now, one of the key things to remember is when you're talking to be truly broken people, when someone becomes a Christian, God doesn't change their past. We all realize that, right? God never changes their past. God doesn't ask them to change their past. So what happens is someone who's been divorced multiple times who becomes a Christian is still divorced multiple times. Someone who's been sinned against, someone who's been abused as a child becomes a Christian. They were still abused as a child. Someone who's committed murder and they're in prison can become a Christian, but they still committed murder and they're still in prison. Someone who is addicted to alcohol or drugs who becomes a Christian is still addicted to alcohol and drugs in most cases. And so you have to understand that they're going to be able to recover and pursue God's design the best they can from right here, right now. But this is their opportunity. So you're going to share the gospel. And then I stands for invitation. You've got to give people a clear invitation to repent of their sins and believe in Jesus, to receive Him by faith. And how do you, so what I do, after I've drawn this thing for them, I ask them a simple question. I say, hey, we started talking about this because you said your wife was a B word. Where do you think you are right now on this diagram? If you had to pinpoint your life, where do you think you are? Well, almost every single person you will ask is going to say, I'm either right here in this circle, or I'm somewhere between here and here. Almost all of them will say that. And the reason they'll say it, they'll say I'm in brokenness because they realize I'm just broken. I need help. Or even in the process of this conversation, they're trying to communicate, I'm broken. I'm kind of recognizing I need to do something different, but I'm not quite there yet. I haven't figured it all out yet. That's where they point. But you've got to give an invitation. And the invitation, just like every gospel tool, is very simple. Is there any reason why you wouldn't want to receive Jesus by faith right now? Is there any reason why you would not want to turn from your sins, repent of your sins, and believe in Jesus right now? And I'd invite them to do it. And when you do that, you're going to get what we call, because we're simple family church, you know. We're not sophisticated like Presbyterians. You guys will probably have a better system. But we come up with red light, green light, yellow light. If you share this, some people are going to give you a red light. They don't want anything to do with it. Hey, I appreciate that. That's not for me. I'm not interested. Okay. Some people are going to give you a yellow light. I have to think about that. I want to think about it more. I'm not turning you down. I'm not accepting it, but I want to talk about it some more. I want to think about it some more. And some people are going to give you a green light. I'm ready right now. How do I do it? When you have a green light, of course, you have to be ready to lead someone to Christ. I prefer to do it using a version of the sinner's prayer. Now, some of you may have not like that language. That's fine. You come up with how you do it. But the way I do it is because it's an open source tool. I use a sinner's prayer, so I actually lead them through a prayer. And the reason I lead them through a prayer is I think they're probably already believers before they voice this prayer because they've already put their faith in Christ. But I'm trying to give them their first theology lesson with this prayer that we're going to say together. My first act of discipleship is to take this person who's believing in Jesus and begin to help them put some words to what their new faith looks like. But you do what you want with that. And then, if I get a red light or a yellow light, my goal is to always extend the conversation. Is it possible to extend the conversation? Can I make an appointment for later? Can I follow up? Can I get their email address? Can I connect them with the church wherever they live? Is there a way I can serve them? Is there a need with them that I can meet? They don't want to accept Jesus, okay, but hey, you know, I actually do this stuff for a living. Would you like to sit down and talk next week and let's talk more about your marriage? Because what I want to do is constantly extend the conversation, and then all I'm going to do as we extend the conversation is I'm going to always come right back to this. Because God's design gives me a template. It gives me a template for everything. Sexuality, gender, marriage, family structure, parenting, money, faith, career, friendships, loyalty, all these things. How to deal with injustice, how to deal with racism, how to deal with poverty, all these things. God has a design for it. And whatever the problem is we're talking about, I have a way to have a gospel conversation.
So there's a couple things I love about this specifically for you as the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. You already have this language built into pretty much everything you do. Creation, fall, redemption, restoration. You guys believe this. You're better at it than most of us Baptists. So if you look at this and you think about a tool that can be useful for you, as Jimmy just said, an introductory with every new believer or every person you encounter, an introductory way for you to kind of drip some good news to people and point them to what you believe and where your church is headed and giving them a little vision, you can talk about creation, fall, redemption, restoration right here. So I really, I think that's awesome. I also think that right now, with figuring out the coaches and the coordinators and your presbytery structure, in a lot of ways, you're better set up to do this than most other denominations. You're better set up to train churches and whole regions in evangelism than a lot of other people. And so I hope you press into that and embrace that, because this could be a really special season for your network of churches here in the EPC. As Jimmy just mentioned, the red light, yellow light, green light, a great place for you to see that in the Bible is Acts 17. Mm-hmm. So if you remember, the Apostle Paul is addressing the Areopagus. He's there. He's talking. In him we live and move and have our being. He's giving them kind of this big picture view of who Christ is, and he's trying to have a gospel conversation in kind of a tense environment. And if you remember, at the end there in verse 32, it says this. So after he does his presentation, verse 32, it says, "Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked." Which light do you think that is? It's your red light. But it goes on. Others said, we'll hear you again about this. Which light do you think that is? Yellow light. Then it says, so Paul went out from their midst, verse 34, but some men joined him and believed. Green light. If you want a good place to explain to your people where they're going to see this lived out right on the pages of their Bible, go to Acts 17 and they will see red light, yellow light, green light, and how Paul was used of God there. So, just to kind of recap, so there's your three circles. Jimmy's handwriting is pretty awesome, but your three circles. But here's what we're trying to do, right? Here's what we're trying to encourage all of our people in our churches to do. To figure out how they can take an everyday conversation, they transition that conversation, they use a gospel tool, a gospeling tool, like the three circles, to then explain to them the good news of Jesus Christ. So that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to train our people. Take everyday conversation, turn it into a gospel conversation. And then invite people to respond to Jesus. And Lord willing, when you have some new believers, you'll start training up new disciples and training them in the three circles. So here's what I want you to do. You guys got a blank piece of paper there. Fold it in half. And I want you to use half of that with somebody sitting next to you. I'm going to time you. And we're actually going to put this to work. This is what we do at Family Church. I had 50 people with me last month that went through a three circles training at Family Church Sherbrooke. This is what we do with them. We're going to do it with you. We're going to practice together. We're going to get some reps in right now. I want you to take 3 minutes with somebody with you. I'm going to time you. And I want you to work on sharing this tool with them. All right? 3 minutes, then you'll switch. I'll give you a cue there. But see,
gotta
if you can
fast.
Summarize this. Don't get too theological about it. Just do the best you can to summarize
it. Fast.
And show the tool to the person next to you. Ready? First person, go.
All right, so a couple things, guys, before we're going to take a break in just a moment, but a couple things I'd like to just say to you guys when it comes to the three circles. I think you can already tell that when we share something like the three circles, it's kind of an intuitive tool. So when you are using it, you can recognize that I saw some of you like, couldn't remember what the second circle was, so you're like looking up there and coming up here and oh my gosh, what? But I think if you'll just think of it like this, if you'll think of it as just three circles and three arrows, because what it really is designed to be is not a script. It's designed to be a map for a conversation that you already know how to have. It's a map. It's a way for you to move the conversation forward. So I don't need to draw that to do it. I know, but if you'll try this, you'll figure this out. When you sit down with a far from God person and you're holding a napkin or on the back of a paper menu at a restaurant or in your office and you begin to draw something, even though it's just arrows and circles, it's amazing how bad they want to see what you're about to draw next. I'm just saying, it's human nature. I just did it this week. I was sitting with a couple and I said, look, let me show you this, because they were talking about their, South Florida, man. This guy was in the mob. I'm not making this up, and I was scared. But anyway, I was drawing this circles, and I was showing him. And as I'm drawing it, it's just a circle with a word in it. And then I'm drawing. Hey, can you move your hand for me? I didn't see that one. It's another circle, and it's got another. And I was just amazed at how. And so there's something about the visual that keeps people coming back. And so if you'll think of it, if you'll not try to memorize this as a script, and just try to think of it as a conversation map. God's design, sin, brokenness, repent and believe, the gospel, recover and pursue God. If you can just kind of get the outline of the map, it almost doesn't matter what the Spirit of God leads you to say in the in-between. The Spirit of God will give you part of your testimony, the right Bible verse to share, or whatever. When you're training other people who don't have the background or the expertise that you do, I recommend if you can just teach them the simple three circles, three arrows, they can remember it. And it's amazing what even a brand new Christian can do with the three circles. It's amazing how good they are at talking people through it. And so I just encourage you not to stress out or allow people to stress out, but just think of it. This is just a map. It's just a map of where I'm going with the conversation so I can keep it moving. And it lets me keep the people with me because they can see that it's a map and we're going somewhere. And so if you think of it that way, then you won't be so, you know, freaked out about, oh my gosh, I didn't say that right. Just don't worry about that. Three circles, three arrows. It's really simple.
Yeah. So how'd you feel about doing the tool? Everybody do all right? I remember I was at the Presbyterian, the Alleghenies. Any of the Alleghenies folks in here? All right. So I remember hearing one person in the room like trying to add a fourth circle to it. And I said, man, please don't do it. Please don't do it. And then Bob's like, Presbyterians have a way of overcomplicating everything. And so, you can see, like, you might find your own hiccups and where you struggle. There's going to be places where you can double down on maybe some of the training you do with folks. But, again, simple, intuitive, easily reproducible. So easily reproducible. A couple months ago from Tampa Covenant Church, Mark Farrell was with us in a conversation here. So, Mark, I'm going to have you come up before we take a quick break. I'm giving you 3 minutes and a marker. Okay? Now, I know most preachers, you give them a mic. This is, I'm going to ask the Spirit of God to just empower you to do this in 3 minutes, all right? I want you to work through this and show people how you would use this tool. Somebody comes to you, they're dealing with some brokenness. I want you to walk them through.
I didn't know I was going to do this.
We'll
take it. I was just with Richie, and Richie and I were together in February, we did it for the first time. So I think I improved a little bit, right, my brother? Yes, I did. And so I do, some people would start with brokenness, but I do start with God's design. I'm going to put GD here, and that means God's design, right? I will start with God's design, and Jimmy stayed true to the book, especially when he talked about the transition that we make. And it was good to hear that today as well. And so God has a design for whatever it is in your life. If you want to go back to the scriptures, we talk about God creating Adam and Eve, and he declared them to be good. He blessed them and empowered them to fulfill his design. However, they sinned. They rebelled against God and wanted to live according to their own design. And that leads to all of the brokenness that we witness in the world. And we can pull a plethora of things that we see as far as the squiggly arrows are concerned and how they snap back, because there's nothing that we can do to get out of this brokenness. But what I really appreciate Jimmy reiterating is the fact that we know in brokenness there's a need and a desire for change, but that change does not come from within. It has to happen outside of us. That should be a bell ringer. And then, of course, that leads to the good news. And being Presbyterian, I would say that God comes down and he does what we could not do for ourselves. He lives the life that we should have lived and died the death that we deserved as a punishment for our sin. But yet he was not left in the grave. Of course, Christ raised from the dead on the third day, declared to be Lord and King. And because of that, he came to die and receive that punishment for sin and heal the brokenness in the areas in our lives. So what are we supposed to do? Repent, turn from sin, love what Jimmy says, change your mind, change your heart, change your direction, and then, of course, believe in the good news of the gospel. And, of course, if people don't like the believe word, we can say trust. And then I would include a little bit of grace right here, that God, by his grace, gives us the power to recover and to pursue his design for our lives. And then just kind of loving the invitation, where do you see yourself on this map? If it's a green, then we're going to pray. If it's a yellow, we're going to follow up. If it's a red, we're not going to get discouraged. Throw the net out one more time.
All right, so listen, man, I love that. And for a small fee, Mark can come to your church and write GD on a board. All right, so man, that's awesome. And I think it's helpful. You can see how quickly Mark's got some language already that he uses at Tampa Covenant, and he's got some things that are on his mind already when it comes to brokenness. That's just the simple, intuitive nature of the tool. Here's what we want you to do. I want you to take about a 5 to 7 minute break. Let's just say, how about this? Be back in here at 10:20.